these words that you've heard before? All right, good. I heard like two muffled yeses.
Cool.
So what does anybody remember what domain relates to? Your graph, or that exist in your graph. So if domain are your x values that exist in your graph, what's range? Very good, thanks Kumar. Those are your y values that exist in your graph. One of the things that I try and do is, whether it's helpful or not for you, is give you some tricks and some ways to remember things. So I know that a lot of times figuring out and remembering that domain relates to X and range is Y. Robin, do you need to put that away? Thank you. Is kind of tricky, and maybe you get them stuck in your head like the opposite way. But I like to think about it in terms of the alphabet. Right, so D is before R in the alphabet, X is before Y in the alphabet. So your domain is always going to relate to X, your range is always going to relate to Y. Any questions so far? Okay. The next thing is that domain and range can be listed in different ways. Okay, there's what we call set notation. Inequality notation. And interval notation. I'm going to show you all three, and then you're going to decide which one you like the best. You need to be able to recognize them, but how you write your domain and range doesn't matter to us. So pick the one that you're most comfortable with. So first of all, I'm just going to show you a graph, and then we're actually going to relate this to what we've been doing. Start with this. And just in case it's hard to see, my points are at 1, 1 and 4, 3. And the one at 1, 1 is an open circle for a reason. Anybody seen those open circles before? Yeah? Okay, good. So hopefully still review, but maybe it was kind of hard the first time, didn't quite get it. Awesome. So this is a line segment, right? It has ends, so it's not a full line with the arrows. I did notice a lot of you on your homework last night forgot about your arrows. You have to have them there, because otherwise we assume it's a segment and that it stops. So please make sure when you're graphing, like the warm-up, that you do have the arrows on it. Today we're going to graph lines and cut parts of it off. Robin.
If you have a line segment and you don't write the arrows, but you also don't write the dots, what happens?
You have to have one or the other. So you should have dots to indicate endpoints. If you
a line segment.
Well, that's true. I guess in like geometry, a line segment, they just showed the line with no dots. I think you're going to find life easier if you indicate the dots. But required, not necessarily, unless it's an open dot. And then it has to be there. Okay, good question, Robin. Thank you. All right, so when we are looking at a graph, domain are all the X's that exist within the graph. Is this super review? Not really? Okay, good. Excellent. care about are the x values. So I'm going to look, and we always go left to right, smallest to biggest, and I'm going to see that for the x's, it goes from 1 to 4. That's where it exists on the x-axis. So when I do my domain, I'm going to say that my graph exists between 1 and 4, and I'm going to do it in three different ways just so you can see. Before I list them, we're going to go over what an open circle versus a closed circle means, so that when we list and write our notations, we're not going to mess them up. So an open circle, what that means is that, this point right here at 1, 1 is actually not included in our graph. That this line goes like so super close to 1, but never actually gets there. So to indicate not included, we do an open circle. And when we're writing these things, when we're writing our domain, we're either going to use a parenthesis or we're going to use greater than or less than. But with an open circle, it's never going to be equal to. A closed circle, we're going to use a bracket or we're going to use the equal to. So less than or equal to or greater than or equal to. The parentheses and the bracket are used for interval notation. And then the inequality signs are used for, surprise, inequality and set notation. So this is just looking at a graph and being able to list domain and range, which you actually don't have a lot of homework. You don't have any homework on that tonight. We will do more with it on Monday. But being able to cut off the graph is going to be the biggie too. So if I'm listing my domain in these three different notations, I'm going to do set notation starts with, I know there's a fancy term for that squiggle thing. Does anybody know the fancy term? Is it a brace?
Yeah, bracket.
Okay, I think this is a brace.
No, it's a brace.
Yeah, it's a brace because this is a bracket. So you start with the brace, set notation, then you're going to say what letter we're looking at. So we're looking at the letter X for domain. And then we're going to put a line, which means such that, super mathematical. And then we're going to do the numbers where it exists. So we're going to do 1 and 4, and I'm going to leave some space. And X is going to be between those numbers, okay? So X is greater than 1, that's how you read it. And then at 4, we have a closed circle, so I'm going to use the one that has an equal to sign. Both of these symbols are going to face the same direction. Both of your inequality signs are going to face the same direction. So that's set notation for domain. Inequality notation is super easy because all you're going to do is take the inequality piece of set and bring it down. So X is between 1 and 4. Interval notation is my favorite because it's shortest, so I like shortcuts. Interval notation means you just use the two numbers separated by a comma, so it kind of looks like a point. It's not a point, it's an interval where things exist.
What if you're in Europe?
But we're going to use 1 and 4 And then with interval, I just have to decide whether I'm using the parentheses or the bracket. So with the one open circle, using the parentheses, four is a closed circle, so we're gonna use a bracket. So if I'm listing domain, which is all we're gonna do for right now because I want you to be able to see how to graph using domain and range. If I'm just doing domain, that's how I would list the three different types of domain, or different notations. They all say the same thing. It's just a matter of which one you like the best. How many of you are thinking you like set notation the best? Yeah, I know that one sucks. Inequality? Anybody liking that one? Yeah, a couple of you. Cool. And interval? Is that the majority? Yeah, me too. All right. Cool. So now let's take this and actually relate it to what we did yesterday and the day before with actually graphing. So we're going to take our equation, and I'm the same one from the warm-up. And I'm going to do y equals 3x plus 4. But I'm going to put what's called a domain restriction on it. Okay, so I'm going to tell you that your domain goes from negative 1 to 2. All right. There's always more than one way to do this, right? So one way is graph your line just like you're used to doing, and then just erase and add your open or closed circles. That's one way of doing it. I'm going to show you the way that I think is going to be the easiest for you. Is everybody okay if I do like the easiest way on everything?
Yeah.
Right? Like, you all said that you have troubles with math, so the easier I can make it, the better. All right, so domain means what? X. So I'm being given two X values already, which means if I were to set up a t-chart, I already know one of my X values is negative 1, and one of my X values is 2. With negative 1, and I'm just going to write myself a note so I don't forget. With negative 1, what type of a point is it going to be?
Open.
Open. Nice. Good call. So I'm going to write myself a little note there. And with 2, what type of a point?
Closed.
They're not always going to be 1 and 1, right? You might have them both closed, both open. You never know. So now all I'm going to do is plug those values in for x and solve. Alright, so I'm going to do y equals 3 times negative 1 plus 4. And then what you can do in your fancy pants graphing calculators that you're all supposed to have at this point is on your main screen, type this in exactly how you see it.
How can we do this without a graphing
calculator? By hand. Have fun. That's why the graphing calculators are required. Okay, so feel free to do it by hand if you want to. These numbers are simple enough. They won't always be. Right? So get on that graphing calculator situation.
Oh, I need a graphing calculator.
All right, those of you that haven't, have you typed it in? What'd you get?
One.
One? All right, so I'm going to plot a point at negative 1, 1, that's open. Okay, and then I'm going to do the same exact thing, but I'm going to plug in 2. And I know that for some of you, especially some of you who are not freaked out by math, doing this in your head is super easy. And I know you probably had some teacher at some point in time that was like, "Don't use a calculator for simple math." Did anybody ever have that?
No.
Okay, we want you to use the calculator for everything. So seriously, like, make sure you're right. We're making you get these really expensive, crazy calculators. Use them. Okay? Use them to your advantage.
Probably.
So what does this one come out to? Yeah, go ahead. Thank you. 10. Oh, I didn't leave myself enough room, so here's what I'm going to do, and you're allowed to do this. We just label. Right, so 2, 10, it's a closed circle, and connects. Bam. So with these ones, it's not even really like the graphing that you did last night that I know some of you are still maybe struggling on and need to come in for office hours. Right, these ones are literally just plug in and chug in. Okay, that's it. Robin, what's up?
Will you dock us points if we draw the lines quickly because we freehanded it?
I mean, squiggly versus, like, I can tell you specifically when, like, this, that's very different. If I can tell you specifically when, like, this, then yes, you're going to get docked. If it's off a little bit, you're fine. Okay. All right, what other questions do you have about this? What if I asked you to list the range for this? What is the range? Emmett?
Would it be 110?
Very good, right? Because y-axis, it's going to go from 1 to 10. How else could I have done that? Where else do you see 1 and 10? In the table. So once you find your points, you're already being given range or domain, vice versa, right? So my range is 1 to 10. We always go low to high. And then my 1 has an open circle, so I gotta go parentheses. 10 has a closed circle, so I'm gonna go bracket. What can I clarify? What can I help you with? Yes, Catherine.
I told you the calculator too, but since I don't have it, can you explain if you can find those numbers?
Sure, absolutely. So you would just start by doing your multiplication would come first, right? So you'd say 3 times negative 1 is negative 3. So then I'd have negative 3, and then I would add negative 3 plus 4. And negative 3 plus 4 is going to give me my positive 1. So just always do your multiplication first, and then add on. Does that help, Catherine?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for asking. I really appreciate it. Emmett?
I'm still a little bit confused on how to assemble the tables.
Okay, so the table is all dependent on what you're given.
Okay.
So in this case, I was given domain. Mm-hmm. So domain means x values. So I know that these are two at different x values. This would be like x1, x2.
Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. All right.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. The same thing would happen is if instead of domain, right, instead of domain, if I gave you range, right? Let's say I wanted your range to be from 1 to 10. And I'm changing the problem just a little bit, just to review. Yeah. If I gave you the range instead, what would that mean? Go ahead, Ella. Yeah, I'd plug it in for the y instead of the x, and then I have to do a little bit of solving. How many of you struggle a little bit with solving and like me to go over a solving problem? Thank you for being honest. Those people threw up your hands. All right, so we know that this is like y1 and y2. So I'm going to set up my table. Oops, sorry. I'm going to have a 1 and I'm going to have a 10 in the y's. From the brackets, I know that both the y's are going to be closed. And then I'm going to plug each individually in for the y. So the first one, I'm going to do 1 equals 3x plus 4. Just to review solving with you, does anybody remember doing the order of operations? What was that thing that you learned? Yeah, say it louder, Catherine.
PEMDAS,
good.
I think she is my dumbass, so.
Robin, not appropriate. So with PEMDAS, that is for when you're figuring out order of operations. When you're solving, you actually go backwards. Okay, so you start with either addition or subtraction. So I'm going to start with this plus 4. So I'm going to, if it's positive 4, I'm going to do the opposite. So I'm going to subtract 4 from both sides. And yes, it spells sad enough. And I'm going to get negative 3 equals 3x. After I've done adding or subtracting once, I'm not going to do it again. Okay? The next thing I'm going to do is either multiply or divide. And in this case, I'm going to divide both sides by what's by x. So now I'm going to get negative 1 equals x. So that's going to go here. Okay, then I'm going to do the same thing with the 10. We're out of time and I need to get your homework. But what other questions do you have? All right, we went a little easy on you tonight. There's only 4 questions for homework. Each of them have a restriction, either domain or range. If you want some graph paper, you're welcome to grab some before